we played in a old Nazi bomb shelter.
Wow.
So it was like 15 foot underground. The walls were like 5 foot thick. And the Soviets had, when they started taking control of Poznan, they then started using this, well, it's now a nightclub, obviously, but they started using it as like a communications hub. So in the green room, there's all this old Soviet communication equipment that's too heavy to lift back out. So it was just like, you just end up in crazy places like that.
Thank you for tuning in to the latest episode of the After Party podcast. On today's episode, I have DJ, label owner, and one half of Craigie Now's, Hunter Mitchell. If you do enjoy today's episode, then please give us a like, subscribe. Please also feel free to give us a share. Share us on social media or send the episode over to your friends. And that way you'll help us grow the platform and engage with more listeners. Thank you for listening.
So how are you feeling?
Pretty good. A little bit tired, but not too bad.
Not too bad. For everybody listening, you were playing last night at Village Underground.
Yeah.
In London, Alien Communications Party.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah, it was like the first time I'd played back-to-back. Well, me and Max have both played back-to-back with Sai from, well, he's playing as Alien Communications now.
That's
on
right.
His own. So it was good. It was, I think when you get booked to play back-to-back with someone, you sometimes don't know how it's going to go, but I think we've got fairly similar tastes in music, so it wasn't something that I was worried about, and it went really well, to be fair.
It went well. Did you speak to him about the set beforehand? Was that something that you kind of went back and forward and maybe discussed, like what you would play? Or
no, not really. I think there was like a brief message about starting out with ambient and then just building it up from there. But I think going on, just kind of conversations that we'd had about music in the past, and that we both, well, all three of us were pretty comfortable about what was going to happen. So
nice.
There wasn't any left field things really coming out of the woodwork. It was good.
Nice. Bounced off each other. Right? Yeah. Yeah. What was, what did you think of the venue? I think we'd kind of spoken about it off camera.
It's cool. It's like a cavernous place, which can be difficult for sound, but actually I was really pleasantly surprised. It's not the type of place that we play very often as well. So it was nice to do something different in like a big room.
It's a big space, eh? Yeah, really big space. What is the capacity then?
I think it's 800,
right?
I think. And I think it must have been pretty close to full when we were there.
It was full, aye. What time was the party going on till, was that?
So we were on 10:30 till 1:30, and then Luca Lozano was playing, and then Katie and Papa Nugs were on at the end, and I think it went on to like 5.
Right, nice.
But I didn't make it.
No.
That long.
Was that particularly because you had the podcast today, because you were coming here? Did you rein it in with this in mind, or did you?
To be honest, neither of us, I think we've done the majority of our partying, so now it's kind of a case of we'll stay and hang out with a few friends for a bit afterwards, but if we're not on last, then it's pretty seldom that we'll make it to the end.
I can relate to that, definitely. I feel similar, to be honest. I think when you're doing it all the time, for years on end, it can kind of grow tiresome a little bit, the party side of it, right?
Yeah, I think, and the whole reason we're doing it is because we like DJing and we like music. So when we've kind of done the thing that we've gone there to do, we've both got like stuff at home that we need to be responsible for. So
yeah,
it's a boring answer, but it's just kind of the way that it is now.
Yeah, no, for sure. I mean, to be honest with you, a few people have said that have been on the podcast, a few different guests that I've had on that also DJ professionally as well. They've kind of said they like to go and DJ and actually don't really enjoy being on the dance floor as much these days. They kind of, they go get the kick out of the DJing and really enjoy that part of it, but they like to go home and take it easy afterwards. So it's not, I don't think it's unusual, especially for someone who's doing it as regularly as you are, you know? So I suppose you've probably played in London a fair bit, have you?
Yeah, it's outside of Glasgow, it's probably the place that we get booked for the most, I think, just because there's so many people there. And not that we're into like niche music, but there's probably a smaller scene than there is with other more popular styles of dance music. So London's kind of the common denominator when it comes to more like underground sounding stuff. So yeah, we play quite a lot.
What are some of the other venues that you've played at then?
Played at Mixed Garage. That was really good. That was a few years ago. I'm trying to think where else we played. Played at a place in Peckham. Played at Peckham Rye. And then we played, there was another place in Tola, a club called Tola. That's really, really good. Last time we played in there, it was, I think there was like a heat wave and their air conditioning was broke. So it was like 36 degrees. So that was the one time all the door staff were like, if you want to take your clothes off, you can just take your clothes off. It's fine. So we ended up playing there. That was really good.
Did you take your clothes off?
I didn't. No. No. I didn't want to ruin everyone's night. The other play, we played Fold as well. That's my favourite club in London.
Yeah, yeah.
That was really good. That was a few years ago. We did a label party there with Jensen Interceptor, Repton, Carol Finlow, and Minu, who works at Boiler Room as well. Jules. She's a really good DJ. But that was a fun party. But I've always been meaning to go back to actually have a night out there, but I've just never managed it yet.
I think I remember seeing that on Resident Advisor, I think, or I remember seeing it advertised as, yeah, it's an amazing club, right? It's definitely, for me, I'd say it's probably the best club I've been in London. Maybe it's one of the best clubs in Europe, I would say now.
They do it properly. Like, they care about the people that are going there. I think they've even got, like, a qualified doctor on site at all times. Wow. They've got a fund where if someone takes ill or they're, like maybe had too much to drink or whatever, they've got someone who will accompany them home and pay for the taxi and then they'll come back to the club, which is the way that's going above and beyond. But I think a lot of other clubs could take a leaf out of their book and try and show a bit more care, because at the end of the day, people are there to kind of forget about everything else that's going on in their lives, and sometimes they will just take it too far. It's just the nature of the scene.
That's definitely, I mean, you feel that when you're at the club. You feel like every little detail, from the door staff on the way in to the people that take your money at the door, cloakroom, everything just feels like they care about it so much.
Yeah.
And then, I mean, obviously the crowd is it's an amazing crowd that the venue attracts as well. I feel like from clubbing there, to me, it kind of feels the most like clubbing in Berlin or somewhere in Europe.
It's very European, the way that it's set up, and the atmosphere is, if for some reason you can't get to Berlin, if you want something that's of a similar ilk, I would say Fold is. Apparently the White Hotel's really similar as well in Manchester.
Oh, yeah.
Where they do the meat-free parties. That's another one that I'd love to go to, but I've not been yet.
Yeah, I think my girlfriend was living in Manchester. I think she was telling me about the White Hotel, but I've not really been to anywhere down there outside the Warehouse Project.
Yeah.
Unfortunately, I think pretty much every time I've been there, it's just been to go to Warehouse Project and then leave. But I'm sure there's a wicked scene as well. I definitely need to check it out.
Yeah, there is. I don't think there's as many clubs as there used to be, but I think anyone that I speak to who's been to the White Hotel says it's proper.
So after this, you're heading back up to Perth, right?
Mm-hmm.
That's where you're from?
Yeah.
From Perth. What was it like for you growing up there?
Probably just the same as anywhere else, just with like less people. There's not really like a scene as such. They had the Ice Factory, which was like super popular in the 90s. At the time, it had like a 2,000 capacity and it would sell out like every Saturday night, so it was open once a week. But I think there was even like older DJs and people that went clubbing in Perth that I'm friends with said that they used to have buses coming from Wales every weekend to go to the Ice Factory. And I think that was more kind of, it wasn't kind of American Detroit and Chicago dance music there. It was more kind of like UK kind of progressive Balearic stuff as well that they were kind of more into. So the rumba was the main party there. And I was too young. I think that maybe stopped in like 2004, 2005. So I would have been about 12 or 13, but just hearing stories, it was kind of infamous.
Mm.
And then, yeah, we just kind of started putting on little parties ourselves and it kind of snowballed from there.
Mm. So you kind of, I suppose you were exposed to the culture without actually going to the club. Mm-hmm. Like maybe, was there people, like older people in your community and stuff like that were kind of telling you about it? Yeah,
so my uncle was a DJ, not professionally or anything, but he collected records and so did my big cousin as well. And my first introduction into like dance music was through him, and it wasn't any specific genre. It was just kind of like old Relief record stuff, like the really hard, like tracky Chicago stuff. Then a band called Red Snapper, who are from London. It was like they play live drum and bass as well with like a big double bass.
Wow.
And not so much dance music, but just like Jamiroquai records and...
Love Jamiroquai.
Who else? The Streets,
mm.
that sort of stuff. So not specifically one type of dance music, but just something that kind of, I was like, holy shit, what's that? Because I just heard stuff that my parents played and they're not overly musical.
Right.
But I was lucky in the sense that my uncle was into what I would class as like good alternative music.
What age would you have been around then?
Like 9 or 10.
Right, okay.
So my uncle's only 14 years older than me, so he's not like, there's not a massive age gap, so he's more like a big brother. So anything that he did growing up, it was like, oh, I want to, like, you always try and emulate kind of the older ones in your family, really, the ones that you think are like cool or whatever.
He was like a role model, almost like male role model kind of thing.
Yeah,
that's cool. How did that then develop into you starting to DJ, or at what point did you realize that you had such a strong passion for music that you wanted to do something musical yourself?
I think the fact that a couple of our older friends had started getting into dance music, mm-hmm. and then I think around like 2006, 2007, it was like when indie rock was like massive. So I think everyone in that generation kind of went through a phase of being into that sort of stuff. And then we used to go to the reading rooms on the train in Dundee, and we used to go through there when we were like 16, 17 and climb the wall to sneak in.
Wow.
It's like a 15 foot stone wall. And I still look about 18 now, so I have no idea how I never got kicked out all the time then. But we used to sneak in there, and that was kind of really harsh, like French electro was in at that time.
Yeah, yeah.
But you can't really pick and choose what's available when there's not like a massive scene. Mm. So that was kind of the gateway into being like, oh, this is what nightclubbing's like. And I think a few of us that instantly struck a chord more than going to like a live venue, because generally the sound's actually better in nightclubs where dance music's playing and you get to hear the music at its full capacity. Whereas I think a lot of bands, especially ones that we would have been seeing around then, it's kind of local bands and there's not like an amazing sound tech on, the sound system's maybe a bit shit. And I think just even like any sort of music, if it's made well, it's like really rousing if it's on like a good sound system. So I think that's where we probably got a lot of inspiration from. And there wasn't an awful lot going on in Perth at all at the time. So rather than getting the train through to Dundee all the time, we're like, let's just like put on our own party and somewhere where we'll be able to get away with it, really, because we're still under 18.
Amazing. Amazing. I definitely went through that phase of the sort of 2006, 2007 indie skinny jeans, Converse. I think I used to wear a waistcoat with a t-shirt and like a wee scarf and I had long hair. Yeah. Like the total brutal look, looking back.
The funny times to look back on. I think everyone, like, I think our generation, that's just what you did. Now it's kind of everyone's, you know, into rather than indie rock, it's kind of, it's moved into like hard, well, hard trance techno sounding stuff.
The stuff that's getting played just now.
Yeah, it's that, the TikTok techno is what this generation's into.
Yeah, TikTok techno's, I've never actually heard it described in that way, but that's a good name for it, to be honest. I mean, yeah, it's almost a bit of a hot topic, a conversation at the moment. I saw the video with DVS1 talking about it. Did you see that? I think he was being interviewed at ADE. He was maybe on a podcast actually. And there was a little snippet doing the rounds of him talking about it. And he was kind of saying similar to what you were saying though, actually, about it being like a gateway. And he wasn't talking too negatively about it, but I think, yeah, it's an interesting, I can't remember everything he said, but it's an interesting little watch if you come across it. But
I think the thing with it is what it stands for. Like, if you're that age, you're very susceptible to kind of being in with the right crowd and doing what you think pleases other people. So if that's the cool thing, then whether people are actually really into it or not, they're going to pretend that they are. And then you're going to get, like, there'll be natural avenues for people to go down where they're like us, like, I don't listen to French electro now.
No.
But that was like the gateway. And this is the same thing for these younger kids as well. Like, they'll get into, some of them will end up not listening to dance music at all. Some will be into like techno, like dub techno or whatever. There'll be loads of different variations, and I think it probably is a phase.
Yeah.
Like, indie rock's nowhere near as big as it used to be. So
no, I know, and it's funny thinking about that, because I mean, to be honest, a lot of that music I still will chuck it on Spotify now and listen back to it, like Arctic Monkeys and stuff like that. It's amazing music, but it's funny to think that it isn't anywhere near as popular. And I don't know if it's to do with technology and maybe how it's so accessible for people to just get Ableton and or get Logic and what have you.
I think that specific type of music as well, because of what's happened over the past couple of years, people weren't able to go to nightclubs, and they've probably learnt about dance music through their phones rather than being taught how to behave in a nightclub, or like the art of, like, say art, but like warming up and all that sort of stuff. Their thoughts of what it is to go out and dance and be in a nightclub is the 15-second clip of like big drops or like people going crazy, and like a full night isn't like that at all.
No, that's a good way to look at it. I think you might be right, because it definitely seemed to me that this whole thing just came right out the back of COVID and lockdown. Mm-hmm. And I actually felt like I noticed a huge difference in the energy on the dance floor right after COVID compared to, well, in DJing in clubs in Edinburgh and stuff like Cabaret Voltaire, where it is young students who are that sort of age group who maybe missed out on the pivotal years, their first clubbing experience. I felt like at those kind of clubs, I really noticed the difference in the energy on the dance floor. And I think you're probably right. I think it has maybe got to do with just getting an education, or a little bit of an education into dance music through like TikTok and stuff.
Yeah, and it's not their fault either. Like, you only know what you know. And if they're not getting the exposure that we were lucky enough to get, then, but I'll come back around again. Unless there's another thing like that happens, hopefully not. But I think it'll just maybe take them a little bit longer to kind of get where they're actually going.
Yeah, I think you're right. So to backpedal a little bit, oh, actually, before I do that, I wanted to ask you, you said French electro, what kind of acts were getting played?
So there was a night called Control Alt Defeat at the Reading Rooms, and they used to book guys like Ado, who's from Dundee. He's actually, I think he's doing really well under another alias at the moment. They used to book, you know, Clouds, the techno artist. They're from Perth as well.
All right, cool.
So they were the year above us at school, but they were kind of into that like trashy electro sounding stuff before they went into kind of more like German techno sounding. Who else? A guy called Xavier Gassaman, who played under the name Don Rimini. Who else was there? What was his name? He had an alias that was like really Wolfgang Gartner.
I remember Wolfgang Gartner. Yeah, yeah.
So
yeah.
He's got a alias that makes like really funky sounding Chicago house.
Oh, cool.
That like Derek Carter and stuff play, but you would never put the two together. But it was only until, what's his name again? It was like Mario Fabriani. That was his like Chicago kind of Derek Carter style house music alias. But then he made kind of that charty electro stuff under Wolfgang Gartner. But it was just people like that that we used to go and see. And I'm trying to think who else. It kind of crossed over between like electro and, can you remember like the Bloody Beetroots and Fake Blood and all that sort of stuff?
Yes, yeah. Yeah. I used to like Fake Blood. I used to, I remember I was like 18 and I was working in Urban Outfitters and I remember them having Fake Blood on, or one of us had Fake Blood on. And I think, I'm sure I went to see him somewhere in Edinburgh, and also maybe saw him at Rockness or something as well. But there was a lot of people around about that time. I mean, Errol Alkin and stuff, like I love Errol Alkin now, but I remember listening to him back then and going to see him playing. And I think there was almost a bit of a crossover from that indie scene.
Yeah,
wasn't
there was, because the Bloody Beetroots played like drums live on stage and all that sort of stuff. So I think that, yeah, you're right. There probably was quite a big crossover.
Yeah, I think so. I remember one night this was maybe a couple years after then. This was maybe like 2009 or 2008. I went to see Foals in Edinburgh at the Picture House, and it was right after their second album came out. I can't remember the name of the album. I've actually got on vinyl somewhere, but the gig was amazing, like unbelievable gig. And it was Halloween, and Simeon Mobile Disco were playing at Cabaret Voltaire. And I went to Cabaret Voltaire after, and they were there, and we met them. So it was, you could see that there was like, there was other bands that were doing DJ sets as well.
We've got after Hot Chip and stuff
Hot
like that.
Hot Chip, yeah, exactly. Hot Chip and Friendly Fires
were
doing it as well, yeah. Yeah, so there was a big crossover. Yeah, actually, to be honest, I look back on that period like quite fondly. I feel like there was loads of cool stuff going on. Like,
it was interesting. Like, it's not stuff that I always, like I don't listen to it now, but if it came on, like it doesn't make me cringe with like the sort of stuff that I used to listen to. I think like it was of its time, and it definitely had a, like it was an impressionable time. And it was part of like the formative years of like finding, because you're not going to just, I think there's very few people that find a style of music when they're like 19 and then they just stick to that forever.
Yeah.
Like, I think you're always kind of evolving and listening to new stuff.
That's it. Yeah. I mean, even in the last few years, I feel like my taste is kind of changing more and more. And certainly in my career DJing, my style, the stuff that I've been playing, has developed so much in like the last 5-6 years, and I'm sure you'll be the same. But yeah, I wanted to backpedal a little bit, because you obviously mentioned that you guys started throwing parties. Where did you actually meet Max? Max isn't here today, and for anybody that's listening that's not familiar with you guys, Craig & Oz as a DJ duo and a label. There's two of you. The both of you were performing last night with Baze, who was also on the podcast recently. So where did you guys meet?
So we met, so we were kind of at schools that were fairly close together at primary. And we used to, there was like a swimming pool disco every like Saturday night. So we used to go to that, and we actually just used to fight with the other, as you do as like a 10 and 11 year olds. And to try and like impress your mates and or like girls from other schools or whatever at this disco, because Perth's quite a small place, so you end up recognising people from like if you play football against them on a Sunday or whatever. So then it was basically just our schools used to knock lumps out of each other. And then in primary seven, at the end of year, you know how like schools will do like a big trip? It just so happened that my school and his school would go out to Holland, Belgium and Germany together and do kind of like a tour. So we did that, and then I think at like the first set of services we stopped at, there was like a bit of a scuffle, and then I don't know who suggested it, but there was some form of like 11-year-olds had a meeting and called a truce that they would stop. That, and in fact, I think it was more like we could probably cause a lot more havoc together rather than like splitting up. So it kind of just started from there. And then you've kind of just been best mates ever since then. So be going on, it's almost like, well, yeah, it will be like 20 years.
Wow, that's really cool. And so how did that then develop into Craigie Knows? So you met each other really young. I mean, you'd said that you'd already started hearing dance music through your uncle at this point.
Yeah, so we kind of went through school being in that kind of like indie rock phase, and then our older friends started DJing, and then we, after being at the reading rooms, were like, oh, we'll just decide to start a party. So we started one at there was a pub at the end of my parents' street that would serve underage kids. So we're like, we'll just start doing Thursday nights there. So there was the student night at the main nightclub in Perth on a Thursday. So we used to do pre-parties to that, and it ended up being more popular than the actual nightclub party. So there was maybe, I mean, at a push it could probably hold 200, but there used to be like 250 people crammed in there. So it was like an old man's pub during the week. Well, every other day actually, apart from a Thursday night. So, and all we had was didn't have any bass bins, it was just two tops and a MIDI controller, no monitors. And probably for the first 6 months, because we didn't know any better, like YouTube rips. So really poor quality YouTube rips. But it was like, again, we didn't have any like kind of point of reference as to how you do it properly. So we just did it ourselves and kind of made it up as we went along, and it seemed to, yeah, we did parties there for a couple of years, and then we had one big party at another nightclub on Christmas Eve, and there was, Perth's not a very big place, I think there was 40,000 people, and I think there was like 600 people at this Christmas Eve party. And then the owner of the Ice Factory had heard about that. I think this is when we were maybe like 18 or 19. And then he basically said, I'll pay for you to book DJs at the Ice Factory, because it had been shut for like 6 years then. So as like 19-year-olds, at the first meeting about putting on the new night, I think 12 of us turned up. And there was like one club owner, and he was like, are 12 of you actually like going to put in any input? And I think after like the second or third meeting, there ended up being like four of us.
Yeah.
Because they were just sitting there just like smiling, like excited at the fact that we were going to get put on a party in a nightclub that had been closed for like 6 years.
Yeah, that's amazing. You must have been popular boys if you were bringing down 600 people to an old man's boozer.
I think what was also good about the going through the reading rooms was that there's four main schools in Perth. So again, I think it's just what you do when you're that age. There'll be trouble between schools, and because Perth's not a big place, you're always bumping into each other. So there was always quite a lot of aggro at a young age. And then as you get a little bit older, you get a little bit more sensible. And we used to see other groups of boys from the other schools coming through the reading rooms. And then we kind of just formed like groups, like a one big group from those four schools. So you kind of know everyone in Perth. And then when we started putting on those parties, that's when you were able to bring in like 600 people, because there was like a couple hundred from each school.
Wow. So that the parties that you'd done at that old man's boozer, that would have been your first gig.
Yes.
That was your first gig. Can you remember much about your first gig? Obviously you were talking about the details of the sound, but can you remember, did you feel nervous? Or?
No, because we were so like young and daft. Like, it wasn't like, I didn't feel like, oh my God, this is like a gig. I think the first one that I actually felt nervous about was my friend Jack got me a gig at the reading rooms to warm up. And I remember driving through from Perth and I was like shaking, because it was the first time I played on like a big sound system in an actual nightclub. And because that was the first nightclub I'd heard dance music in, it was like quite a big deal. But I kind of laugh about it now, but at the time it was like a huge thing. So that was the first time I actually felt like really nervous to do something like that.
Yeah, I bet. And the parties that you've done at the Ice Factory then, so you said that you were getting, this owner of the club was giving you guys money to book guests. Like, what kind of guests were you booking at that age then?
So being like, by that time we had started driving through to Subculture on a Saturday night. So I think our taste had evolved quite a bit, just learning from Harry and Dominic. So we used to drive through on a Saturday night, take a couple cars from Perth, and we'd be like the first ones in, and then just sit and watch them warm up, and then we'd be like the last ones to leave, and then we'd just drive back through to Perth and then turn the turntables on, and then they wouldn't get turned off until Sunday night again.
Amazing.
And it was just, we would do that, like we'd probably be through in Glasgow every second week. So during those couple of years, from maybe like late, maybe like 17 to, yeah, I think we must have been about 20 when those parties at the Ice Factory started. So maybe like 2 or 3 years of solidly going through to Subculture. We all built up record collections. And then, yeah, the first guest that we, well, we actually booked someone that never ended up playing, because I was excited that we got all, so the club owners were used to 90s money, which was like in the music industry in the 90s was, there was so much money going about. So they were used to paying people like Tall Paul, Judge Jules, like £5,000-£7,000 a gig.
Yeah.
And they were making that back because they were getting 2,000 people. So we were like, well, what's the budget? And he was like, well, I can give you like 10 grand for your first party. So I'm like, yes, like, let's do it. So I,
19 years old.
Yeah. I don't know actually if he knows that it was me. But I emailed Geir Janssen's agent at the time. This was when Geir Janssen was getting really big. And I was like, oh, we've like new party at the Ice Factory. And we were like, we better offer him like something decent because it's our first party and like they might not want to come and play. So I was like, we can offer like £7,500. And obviously his agent replied within like 30 minutes and was like, yes, like let's do this.
Yeah.
And then I like waited a couple of days and then I was like speaking to my mates and I was like, do you think like that's maybe a bit much? And then I spoke to someone, I think it was one of the older boys from Dundee, and I was like, we've offered him this. And he was like, are you actually insane? So then I ended up emailing his agent back and being like, I just made something up. Like we've had the night pulled from us or whatever. And he replied saying, Gerd is very upset. He's very angry. I was like, no shit. Like I would be too. So the first few parties were just residents only. And then, yeah. So when we actually came to book someone, the first guest was Dominic from Sub Club. So
yeah,
that was like, I mean, he was, him and Harry were like our heroes growing up in the like formative years of like seeing them the way that they DJed at Subculture. So had Dominic, and then we did pay a lot of money to get Mark Farina. We had him, we had Serge from Clone, John Heckle. I think we booked Orla for the first time. I think that was maybe one of our first Scottish gigs. Jane Fitz, who else did we book? Jamie Trench. We had Jamie play a couple times. Intergalactic Gary. And we had loads of people, like people that you wouldn't sell one ticket for any of those artists in Perth now, but at the time, because we used to do one guest, then one residence party, and the residence parties were as busy as the guests, because we were kind of at like a lucky stage where people just trusted that they would have a good time if they were going to come to Groovement, which was what the night was called. So we ended up running it for like eight, nine years. Radioactive Man as well, that just popped up in my head. We had Keith Tennis, we'd come and play.
Amazing.
LNS as well. I'm trying to think if there was, I think, did they have Sort of Fit? No, I don't think we had, but it was just like really like actual DJs who we were like, we know that they're like really good at what they do, mm-hmm. and we liked them. So we only actually booked people that we liked. It was never a question of, will this sell tickets? Because we knew that it'd be busy regardless of who we had on.
That's a good place to be, right? That's where
yeah,
you
it was super
be.
Lucky at the time. We probably didn't realize how good we had it, because now I'm like, that is not a thing at all anymore. Mm. No matter who you book, you've got to like do social media posts and all that sort of stuff. Whereas at the time, because that was all we knew, we just took it for granted.
Mm. I mean, it's sad. Yeah, that's almost unattainable for a club night now. Yeah. It's so difficult. At this point, was this prior to social media? What sort of year was this?
So this would have been 2009-ish, I think 2010.
So Facebook had just became yeah. popular, really. Instagram wasn't really popular
no,
yet.
No, we didn't use Instagram. We used to use Facebook, and then the events were quite big on that. Mm. We used to just design Mike, who I used to run Groovement with. He used to just design all the posters and stuff like that. So it didn't really cost us an awful lot of money.
Mm.
But I know now that the owners definitely made their money's worth, because I think the first night we must have had like 500-600 people there.
Wow.
And I think we got like 100 quid off the owners.
Really?
But at the time we're like, oh, we're just in it for the music. Like, it's fine. But then I was like, looking back, I was like, we did get screwed over. But
yeah.
It's just stuff that you learn as you go.
It's a learning experience, right? And I mean, it's a good place to be starting as well, you know, starting your DJ career. If you've got someone's trust and you're like that, and they're willing to shell out that amount of money for you to book guests, and sounds like an amazing opportunity, amazing thing. So you've done it for 8 or 9 years.
Yeah. So when we stopped, I was still doing Groovement with Mark and Mike. So Mike Smith and Mark McKinnon. Until maybe like I was doing that alongside when Max and I started Craigie Nows for maybe a couple years, and then I just got too much and it was more difficult. We were struggling to pull in crowds because all of our crowd had kind of moved on and either out of Perth or started to have settled down and not go out as much. So we kind of decided that we'll maybe just do one or two parties a year, and then it's kind of just dissipated into not happening anymore. Mm. But it was just a natural end, really.
Mm. It just kind of phased out naturally. Yeah. It wasn't like a fallout or anything like that.
No, not at all. I'm still really good friends with them.
Yeah, good. You mentioned there that you guys used to go down to Sub Club every second week, and you got a lot of inspiration or learnt a lot of things from watching Harry and Dominic.
Yeah.
There really is no better DJs to be learning your trade from you know, getting to experience that on a weekly or bi-weekly basis. And I think, yeah, there's some really good up and coming DJs coming through Glasgow at the moment, and I think that maybe as a testament to what's going on at Sub Club, and the fact that you're actually able to go and see that every Saturday night. And I think maybe in relation to what you were saying earlier on, you know, now that we're out of COVID and people, like young people that are 18, 19 can actually go out clubbing and stuff, if that's what's on offer and that's your sort of, if you're seeing that as like the standard on a weekly basis, then I'm sure that's probably having a part to play, and like, you know, good young up and comers coming through Glasgow. But both of those guys are probably my favorite DJs. They're definitely up there with like two of my favorite DJs, just as you said.
They're like, yeah, I can't speak highly enough of either of them, and the way that they were with me and the rest of us like coming up, because I think being from Perth, or in fact, if you're anywhere outside of Edinburgh and Glasgow, like we probably do it as well to kind of even smaller towns in Perth, you're like, you just get branded a chook there, or like they don't think that you understand what like a mainstay of their culture and their city means to them, and or basically like they don't think that you get it.
Yeah.
But I think Harry and Dominic kind of saw that we actually were serious about music, and that we gave a shit, like we really did care, and we still do about music, and it's never been anything other than that. And I think they recognize that, and it's been nice to now be friends with them and kind of give them, not that they would ever ask for anything back in return, but I hope it's good for them to be able to see what their inspiration has done to kind of young up and coming DJs in the city and in the country, because without them, I don't know if we would be in the position we are. And it's not because they've actively went to try to do that. All they've done is be good DJs and be good people.
Mm. Yeah, definitely. And have, and yeah, just have such a strong passion for music. Mm. And definitely. Yeah, they're great guys, really, really good guys, good fun. And for anybody that's listening that's not had the chance to see them play, they're at Sub Club almost every Saturday.
Every right? Saturday. Every, I think they've, I don't know if this is the, it's got to be close to be coming up 30 years. It might even be this year. I'm not sure.
Yeah.
It's going to be, it's going to be around now, but, and what's good about it is they're both completely different as DJs as well. So I think you can go to Subculture on a Saturday night, and we would always try and pick out the residence nights over guests, because we felt that that was like the most fun, and you got to see the biggest spectrum of interest in music as well.
Definitely. I'm the same. I would rather go and see those guys play. And I really love Telford's stuff as well. I think he's an amazing DJ as well.
All you don't become a Subculture resident if you're not a good DJ. And same goes for Telford and Stevie Cox as well.
Definitely. Yeah. I've caught Stevie Cox playing a couple of times, and Wicked, you're right. I mean, you don't, as you said, you don't get a residency there if you're not top notch, you know. Just to backpedal a little bit again, the name Craig and I, as you mentioned there, that you and Max started Craig and I, tell me about the name.
So Craigie is an area that Max grew up in, and I grew up just outside, but that was where we would always hang out.
Uh-huh.
And the Nows is a kind of rocky hill that we used to hang out on.
Mm.
And Max stayed on Craigie Nows Road. Mm. So that was the reasoning behind the name. It wasn't like anything more than that. Max previously ran another record label as well that used to press vinyl for like 3 or 4 years. And he came up with the idea, and then I've just kind of been there throughout the whole process, kind of helping as much as I can. He's very good with like business side of things and running a company, whereas I'm horrendous with that sort of stuff. I've got no interest in it at all. So I think it's been a good match throughout the years.
Could complement each other.
Yeah.
He's the yang to your yang, or vice versa. Yeah. So it's a record label. You also do events as well now under that banner, and then you DJ together, the two of you. For a lot of people that are listening, they might actually not realize what's involved in running a record label or setting up a record label, but there might be some people that are listening that maybe have aspirations or would like to try and give it a bash themselves. So could you maybe tell us a little bit about what's actually involved in that?
I think nowadays it's probably as easy as it's ever been, because you've got Bandcamp, so you can just set up your own page. And then if you want to press vinyl, there are quite a lot of places that you can get like 300 records pressed. But we were very lucky in the sense that Max had previous experience running a label. But I think the main thing is just be passionate about what you're doing. You need to kind of have a solid, I would say now probably branding's quite important. You need to have a solid kind of brand and an ethos about the sound that you want to have. And then we were lucky in the sense that we got a P&D deal from Clone in Rotterdam, so they effectively paid for the records to be pressed, and then we take a cut of it. Because it allows you to, if we've not got a lot of money, so it allows us to press numerous records in a row without having to fork out like £10,000-£15,000 for all the outgoings. And I think there's, I know Rub-A-Dub do P&D deals, so do Clone, and then we've recently moved away from Clone, and we're now with One Eyewitness in Amsterdam as well. So there's, I think, just speak to people that run record labels and get as much information as you want. I think the good thing about this scene is people are generally pretty friendly and open to kind of giving advice or sharing their experiences. So if anyone is interested in the ins and outs of it, business-wise, Max is definitely the the best person to ask, especially with spreadsheets. But in terms of music, yeah, also speak to artists that you like. And again, it's very seldom you come across someone that's an arsehole, basically. Generally, people are into music for the right reasons and they want to get their music out there to people. I think there's definitely still a place for labels, although Bandcamp's really important. I think it takes a lot of the stress out of if you're an artist and you want to just get your records pressed to vinyl. I think a label's probably the best way to go rather than taking the risk of getting 300 records pressed and they're all sitting in your bedroom and you're getting rid of them one by one, and then you end up having to give away 150 of them for free just to try and get them out there.
Yeah, for sure. I mean, you were mentioning there about the pressing and distribution deal and vinyl, getting vinyl pressed is expensive, right? Mm-hmm. So to land something like that is obviously pretty good, but there's some P&D deals out there that I hear about that are maybe not actually that favourable and can kind of maybe leave people in a bit of a...
I have heard instances of people not being paid the money that they're due. And I think that's where you definitely speak to people who are in the industry. It goes the same with like booking people as DJs. We always try to do a bit of research into the people that we're booking to make sure that they're like good people, because that's important to us as well.
Definitely.
And we always... it's not always nice to hear. It's nice for us as a label to hear that artists will come to us and say, this has been the smoothest experience I've had with working with a label, and that I think it's important to pay them what they're due, and we always do that. But it's also disappointing to hear that there are labels out there that don't do that. But I think you get in all walks of life, you'll have people that do stuff a way that you think is right and people that don't. But again, I think dance music's generally filled with good people. So I think ask questions, be a sponge and ask as many questions as you can.
Definitely. I think, there's obviously a lot of labels out there as well that are, I was going to ask you about vinyl, because I've got my own label, CB90 Dance Recordings. It's all digital, but I know from my experience running a label that it can also be something where you're just, it's almost like a bottomless pit of putting money in it, and there's a lot of labels that aren't actually getting that much money back. But that's something that I wanted to ask you about, was do you think, what's your thoughts on labels that are only digital, and do you think it's important for dance music labels to be pressing vinyl as well?
No, I think it's just a personal preference. Like, I like collecting records, I like playing records. I don't play exclusively vinyl because I think there's like a time and a place for it, and you can't, like, you'll probably know setups aren't amazing in every nightclub. So if you were just to say, I think Nicholas Lutz only plays vinyl, like he'll only go somewhere and play vinyl. I we can't be as picky as that, unfortunately. But I think it is just personal preference. Some people, I actually don't like vinyl only labels, because I think that music should be accessible for everyone. So as much as I would love for everyone to be able to press vinyl, I know it's not a reality or something that's available to everyone. So I think if it's digital only, at the end of the day, I think if the music's good, it's good, and I would buy it regardless. I would prefer to buy it on vinyl, but at the same time, I don't want to spend £18 on a record for four tracks on it and there's one track that I like.
Yeah.
So I think that's where there's room for both.
Yeah, definitely. That's it. It can be an expensive hobby, buying records as well, right? And I mean, we've all done it. We've bought a record and it's for one track, and like there's maybe like four or five other tracks on it that you've never played, you know? But yeah, it's definitely, there's a lot of, we've spoken about vinyl quite a bit on the podcast, spoke about it for a bit with Baze and Yogi Hotton and stuff. And I think if you love something, it's great to have the record, but there's a lot involved. Like there's a lot of arguments for and against playing and collecting and pressing and yeah.
I just find it more fun playing vinyl. I like the way that it feels. I like having something to do, and I feel like there is like, I think you can learn to play on CDJs probably within like a week. Mm. Whereas I spent like 6 months with a headache trying to work out how to mix vinyl. And it is something that you don't forget once you learn how to do. Mm. But I think it's something that if you watch someone who can mix vinyl really well, it's a lot more enjoyable than just watching someone mix on CDJs, because you can see the process actually happening in their head. And I think it's more difficult to do because you've not got screens. You don't know what key it's in. Mm. You don't know what the BPM is. So I think for me, it's just my preference, but I would never turn my nose up at someone even playing on like a controller.
Yeah.
It's just not what I would personally do, but I've seen amazing sets from people on controllers as well.
Mm. Again, for some people listening, I mean, I'm sure there's a lot of DJs listening as well, but for some people listening, they might not actually really fully understand what's involved in DJing. Some people might think that you are just jumping behind a set of decks, pressing a few buttons. Some people might understand the concept of mixing two tracks together, but they might think that really that's all that's involved. Whereas you and I both know differently, that there's a lot more involved in playing a DJ set to a dance floor crowd of people. So could you maybe speak to us a little bit about your thoughts on the art of DJing?
Yeah, I think the majority of stuff that we learned was off of Harry and Dominic. So we would go in on a Saturday night, and we were the first people in there, and you would see them take it from like ambient stuff all the way up to, and neither of them ever really play very fast either. It'll maybe max out at like 126, 128 BPM. But I think for me, I'm finding, well, personally, over the past couple of years, I've definitely been caught up. Me and Max both have. I've probably playing slightly quicker with that kind of proggy sound that we've released on the label. I think kind of rising up to like 135 to 140 BPM. But over the past kind of 18 months, I've found myself particularly going slower and slower and back to what I know and what I was kind of into for the kind of 10 years prior to what we've been playing recently. And it's not to say that the stuff that we've been playing, I don't like it. That's not the case at all. It's just that I think the older that I'm getting, and the more sure of myself I am as a DJ, I think I'm more comfortable with playing slightly slower stuff. And I think as well, it's actually easier for people who aren't accustomed to dance music to come in and dance all night. Because I know in the early days, if I went into a club and it was 150 BPM from 11 o'clock, I'd be tired and bored by midnight.
Mm-hmm.
Whereas I think it's definitely, for instance, the other week, Max was away, so I ended up playing La Cheetah for myself for 4 hours. And I think by the end of the night, though it was only until the last 20 minutes it went above 126 BPM, but the dance floor was full all night and people weren't exhausted, or they weren't leaving halfway through the night to get a break because it was kind of a gradual build up. And there's obviously a place for the faster stuff, and again, I would never turn my nose up at it, but I just think for me personally, that kind of like dark, like malevolent sounding stuff is a lot more suited to me in the way that I would play. So I think DJing, it's such a personal thing. It's like cooking for someone. It's kind of you're communicating with them without speaking, and the way that I do that is probably at a slightly slower pace now than it has been over the past couple of years.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, there's definitely something really satisfying about starting off the night, if you're opening and closing, like you said, you played at La Cheetah the other week, 4 hours, and starting off at a really slow pace and maybe ambient, like you were saying, Harry and Dominic were doing, and building it up and just building. I like to build the energy up as well, gradually. And I think there's something in that, almost taking, it sounds cliche and cheesy, but like taking the crowd on a journey.
It is. But it's like, again, like it's like cooking for someone, or like actually cooking. You wouldn't put, like, you have to preheat. If, say you're cooking a pizza, you're not going to chuck it in without preheating the oven. Do you know what I mean? It's like, why would you? Or it's like, if you want to eat something, it's like, you're not just going to have a meal all full of like chili peppers, because there's no interest or enjoyment in that. It's like, there has to be layers of different things within the night. And again, and like you said, journey is a, like, is a kind of cliche word, but it is right. It's like, if you, again, or like if you read a book, you don't want it just to be one pace the whole night. You want it to have, like, it's part of an adventure. You want to have bits where it's more interesting, or there's bits where it'll like break pace,
yeah,
and then it'll pick back up again, and then there'll be like a crescendo. And I think as well, there was a study done where people, if you listen to your favorite song, you will get more enjoyment out of that song if it gets paused for 5 seconds and then you start listening to it again. So I think there was something like a 33% rise in enjoyment. If that song, it didn't matter what happened in those 5 seconds, but if that paused and then started again. And I think there's definitely something to be said in that for DJing, because you don't want to just go one pace the whole time, because you'll tire people or you'll bore them, even if it's subconsciously. It's the same with sound systems. If the sound system's not quite right, punters in the crowd will be hammered, but subconsciously they'll keep less interest, because the actual quality isn't there and it's not going to keep their interest as long.
Definitely. Yeah, there's so much science in the sound, isn't there? And the different frequencies and stuff, and how it resonates with your body in like a physical way. I don't know the ins and outs of it. I went to a workshop once with a sound guy, and he was talking about it, and it was really interesting. There's definitely something in that. When you're playing, then how much of the track selection is about what you want to hear versus what the crowd wants to hear?
I think at the start of everyone DJing, it's probably all about what you want to hear. And then I think it'll be pretty much 15 years DJing in 2024 and playing out. And I think you get to the stage where you maybe don't, but you think you know what they want to hear rather than what you want to hear. And I think it gets to the stage where you feel comfortable with knowing what is right for the next track. For instance, the other week, because I was playing on my own, I had two turntables and two CDJs. So I had time to say, right, that goes with that. And then I know what the next two moves are going to be, because you know which records, you've got relationships with your records. Do you know what I mean? It's, you know what goes with what. And I think it's just something that you get used to the more you do it. It's like anything, the more practice that you have, the better you'll get at it. And I think you can't be completely selfish when you're DJing, because it's about, the main thing is making sure that people are dancing and having a good time. So you might have something in your head that you're really want to play, but there's been loads of times where I've queued something up and I'm like, I really want to hear this on the sound system, but for whatever reason, there might not be a time in the night where it's right to play it. And I think that's important, to find those moments and pick the right track. But I said, you know, it's just practice. But I think if I really think about it, it's probably a mix of both, because people come to see you because they trust your taste in music. So it has to be a bit of what you want to hear, but also try and play to the crowd a bit as well.
Yeah, definitely. I feel like you're almost walking a tightrope a little bit. Well, that's how I feel about it anyway. That's my relationship to it. But Yeah, you might have an idea in your head of what you want to play, but at the same time, the crowd are, they're just there for a good time as well. I mean, there's obviously people who are, there's levels to how much people are into the music or are nerdy about the music.
Yeah, I think it depends where you are. And
depends where you are as well. And like you said, you have a relationship with your records, and maybe it's like an advanced chess player who's thinking like 3-4 moves ahead. Like, you could maybe, you think you know how you're going to join the dots to like, I'm going to play this tonight, and you're maybe thinking 3 or 4 tracks ahead. But
and it doesn't always work either. There's been times where I'm like, oh, I'm going to play this track, it's going to sound amazing, and then it's like empties the dance floor. Like, it still happens now where I'm like, oh, I'm going to play this really interesting track, and people will be like, oh wow, I've like never heard anything like that before. And then like Max will look at me and be like where the fuck did that come from? So it still happens, like, yeah. not perfect, but I think you definitely lessen the gaffes as it goes along.
Yeah, definitely. So how do you then prepare accordingly, because you're obviously pretty busy with touring and stuff, you're playing at a variety of different venues, different places. I mean, I mentioned there that I feel like there's levels to how much people are actually into the music, and I think from playing in places like Berlin, I feel like playing in Berlin, the crowd are so much more in tune with what mm-hmm. you're doing, or maybe even like playing in London, playing in Glasgow. But so there's definitely, for me, I think there's things you could get away with more in some clubs in some cities than you could in others. But I wanted to ask you, how do you prepare differently then for each set, playing at different venues? What is there that you need to take into account?
I think you're spot on in terms of, you can get away with more in cities like Berlin. You can probably get away with playing like off-kilter kind of weird stuff for maybe 20 minutes, half an hour, and it won't empty the dance floor, because one, you're probably playing there for 4 or 5 hours, so people know that you're going to be there, and it's not going to be one dimensional the whole time. And it's just, it's part of that culture, is that you're going to be really into your dance music. So I think people are probably a little bit more open to that sort of stuff, whereas we wouldn't probably stray too far in terms of the standard stuff that we play. But I think it's like everything, you go through phases. Mm. And I think for instance, Bristol, you can literally play anything. You can play like Breaks, Acid, all in like the space of an hour, and people just stay there because it's such a diverse musical city. And then if you're, say we're playing in Manchester, we might go like a little bit more techie, because that is, we might be wrong, but that's kind of, each city's kind of, I feel, has got like an individual personality. And although we will play stuff that is kind of quintessentially us, there'll be kind of like little bits added to it that'll kind of like a little nod to the city, basically, through like sprinkled throughout the set.
That's really cool. Do you, other than the geographical location of where you're playing, are there things that you take into consideration, like the size of the room, mm-hmm. Like the size of the crowd? Like, I feel like there's some tracks where I know this is going to work well in a big room, but maybe it's got too much of an epic breakdown, mm-hmm. and like kind of slows the pace down too much for a small room, like the main room in Cabaret Voltaire or mm-hmm. Sneaky Pete's or something like that. Yeah. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah, definitely. I think there's been occasion, and again, it's just like a learning process, like working out what works in different sized rooms, but there's definitely a thought to that. Luckily, we get to play rooms that are maybe like 300 to 600 capacity all the time, which is our favorite sort of stuff to play. But if we are going to play in something that's like, say for instance, we went and played at like a listening bar in Barcelona, and I think it was like a 45 people capacity, mm-hmm. but the sound was really good. But then, you know, and it was invite only, so you knew that like the people that were there, you could play really interesting stuff that kind of fitted with a smaller room. And then if we were going to play like in a big room in Berlin, we'd maybe play stuff that's, you could probably get away with more in bigger rooms, I would say, because you're kind of a little bit more removed from the crowd. So they're kind of going, they're kind of feeding off you as much as with a smaller room, and probably paying more attention to individuals and kind of looking around different groups of people to work out where to go.
Yeah, I think you're right there. I think that's spot on. I think, yeah, I almost wonder though also if the room is really big, like a Printworks, for example, I almost kind of think, does that start to reverse in a way? I think like when you play in a big room, like a 2000 capacity room, you can maybe get away with stuff that's like, that's epic, and there's that many people there that the atmosphere is kind of contained. Like there's energy in the room anyway. But I wonder what it would be like to play somewhere like Printworks or like the Drum Sheds or something. Do you?
I think we would definitely go more towards kind of techno if that was, because I think that there's a reason techno clubs are generally bigger than house music clubs, because it carries well in a bigger space. For instance, like at RSO in Berlin is incredible, and their main room is predominantly techno because it's such a big cavernous room, it works.
So obviously we've been speaking a fair bit about DJing. I can see online that you guys have had a really busy touring schedule, certainly over the last year or so, more than that. So what's life like then as a busy touring DJ?
It is relentless. Like Max and I both still have full-time jobs as well. So having that as well as playing at weekends is pretty tough. It's definitely not glamorous like people say that it is, especially at the level that we do. You know, it's not like we're playing massive like arenas with like 2,000, 3,000 people. It's like generally 300 to 600 capacity crowds, and it's people like us that we're playing for as well. It's not kind of brands or anything like that. So it is, like if you don't love it, then don't get into it, because it is relentless. And you don't actually, if you're also into collecting vinyl, it's like you spend the same amount of money on records for a set that you get paid for doing the set. You know, it's not it's not like a money maker, and it's not something that is, I would say, is glamorous in any way. And the Max and I have both been spoiled because we get to do it together. I think it'd be very, very tough and difficult doing it on your own. I was speaking to Theo about it actually, and he was like, yeah, it is difficult. And I think that's why he's enjoyed doing back-to-backs with people more recently. I know he's still really busy doing it on his own, but yeah, I think it must be, I've not had that experience of, we've had a couple of gigs on our own in Europe and stuff like that, but I think it can be tough. I've got a daughter as well, so I don't want to miss her growing up. So I think this year was kind of, we just went all out because we had the opportunities to do it. But I think next year we'll maybe be a little bit more selective if we can with gigs, because I don't want to miss my daughter growing up. And I know that I'll always be into music, so I can kind of dip in and out whenever I please. I'll still collect records and spend all my money on vinyl, but I think the touring DJ thing is something. Going back to Harry and Dominic was like, I've got the best job in the world. Like I've get to play in Sub Club every week, and they don't have to tour very often. And when I was like 21, I'd be like, nah, touring's the best. And it is amazing because you get to meet people all over the world and play in interesting clubs. But I also see now that I'm a bit older why they do have the best job in the world.
Yeah, definitely. I think, yeah, maybe when you're younger, the idea of that sounds great. But in your position when you've got your daughter, and if you're working full time as well, then I suppose the weekends are kind of time that you would be spending family time and stuff.
Yeah, I mean, without having like a very supportive wife, then it wouldn't be possible. And I think as well, it's something that it, rather than just like us doing it selfishly, you need to have that support around you if you're going to continue to have like a full-time job and have other interests as well.
Definitely. Are there any particular places that you've had the chance to visit and that you would consider to be a favorite, or any highlights that you'd like to share?
We had an amazing like we did like a mini tour of Poland a couple of years ago, and I had no idea what to expect. We got we played in Poznan, somewhere else, and then we were playing in a place called Białystok, which is on the Belarusian border.
Wow.
So we played in Poznan, and we played in we were staying opposite Hitler's old palace in Poznan, and then we played in a old Nazi bomb shelter.
Wow.
So it was like 15 foot underground. The walls were like 5 foot thick, and the Soviets had, when they started taking control of Poznan, they then started using this what's now a nightclub, obviously, but they started using it as like a communications hub. So in the green room, there's all this old Soviet communication equipment that's too heavy to lift back out. So I was just like, you just end up in crazy places like that.
Yeah.
But the people in Poznan, it's quite like a forward-thinking left-wing city, which is cool. And they'd warned us against Białystok, like saying that it was really right-wing, it was really old-fashioned. And I think there was like a huge right-wing militia group that come out of there, and we got like a nine hour train journey from Poznan to Białystok, and we actually didn't have any currency on us either, and they didn't have a card machine, so we went 9 hours without any food and drinks. And I was just like, by the time we got there, it was like all our lips were like stuck to our teeth, and it was like -12 when we got there. There was people like in horse and carts, and then they were saying that you can like look out for tanks, because there's obviously loads of shit happening between Belarus and the neighboring countries. But the guy met us, and that was like one of the best gigs we've ever played. That was also in like an old bomb shelter, and there was this little kind of community of people that hand-built this nightclub. They hand-built the sound system, the shape of the room. And it was like one of the best nights I've ever played. And there's maybe like a community of 300 of them that like run the main guy who runs a festival and is like a sound engineer. They like built this nightclub, and it's a place that's probably even smaller than Perth.
Yeah.
And this nightclub, I think it's actually unfortunately closed down now, but it was full for maybe like 6 or 7 years. And I mean, the general population in that town wouldn't even know that it existed, amongst the kind of old-fashioned Polish general public. And then you've got this little kind of like subculture of people that live in this town who are just really into dance music, but they're hundreds of miles away from like the main cities. And that, doing stuff like that, was more fun than kind of, and more interesting than going to places like Berlin, I would say. So Poland's probably like one of the highlights, and I'm trying to think anywhere else. Newcastle in Australia was really cool as well, and that was similar. It was just like a smaller town than other places that we played when we were over there, but it was just like a really good crowd that were super into it.
That's amazing. Amazing that you've had the opportunity to travel to places like this that you would have never seen.
No.
I mean, like you said, you meet up like so many interesting people along the way. Obviously, you meet a lot of like-minded individuals because you're interested in the same stuff. But the fact that you've been able to do what you love, your passion, and it's taking you to these different parts of the world.
Yeah, for sure.
And that sounds incredible to experience like a venue like that and that kind of thing. I suppose people that are kind of aspiring to get to that level, touring and stuff, they probably think like, oh, I want to play at like Panorama Bar and DC10 and but maybe doing something like that, like you're getting a way more like personal individual experience, and like really I suppose you maybe get to know these people to a certain level as well. Did you spend a lot of time with them when you were there?
We always try and, as long as they're not trying to get you to go back to their flat and get on it with them for like 2 days, like we'll happily spend time with people and try and like eat local food, all that sort of stuff.
Yeah.
And yeah, it was just like really nice to get an insight into a culture and a people that we would probably never actually come across in our daily lives. Even if we were going out as punters, it wouldn't be something that I wouldn't be like, let's go to the Belarusian border for a night out. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah, yeah, definitely not. Definitely not. So what's life like for you outside of music then? You mentioned there that you work full-time as well, but I know that you are a keen runner because I'm seeing your times on Strava when you're sharing them on Instagram, pretty rapid on the...
I wouldn't say keen. I have to do it for football. So I play football still. I'm still trying to flog that dead horse. but yeah, I've actually had a really, really weird running style for years, and then over the I got quite a lot of bad injuries down the right hand side, my knee, ankle and hip. So I just changed loads of stuff with my running style over the past couple of years, and then I used to hate running, but now I don't mind it. So
yeah,
I need it to be a little rat in the middle of the park, basically.
Which position do you play?
Centre midfield.
Yeah. Okay, who do you play for?
Scoon Thistle. So we're a semi-professional team.
Yep.
And we play in the Midlands League. So if you win our league, you go into the Highland League, and then the Highland League plays off with the Lowland League, and then the winners of that go into League Two. So we are in the pyramid system, but I think there's 20 teams in our league, and we've probably got the smallest budget. So, no, it's good. I like it. It keeps me, if I don't exercise, that's when my mental health, I've noticed a big difference in my mental health. So it's more a therapy thing for me as opposed to a vanity thing.
Yeah.
Definitely.
Oh, definitely. I mean, I'm the same as you, man. Exercise is really important for me as well, for my mental health. I feel to be honest, the last couple of weeks, I've not actually managed to get in as much as I would normally do it, but I can feel that it kind of has an effect on my mental health. And I spoke about it on the last podcast that I'd done with Ruri, just saying how I really feel it kind of, exercising regularly just has a positive effect on my personal and professional life as well. I feel like my brain just has more energy. It's I'm able to think more clearly and not as grumpy and crabby.
100%. I think it's actually, I used to be frowned upon even when we were growing up, that it was you look after yourself, you must be, I don't know, there was just it wasn't cool to kind of take care of your mental health or your physical health as well. And I think it's been quite nice over the past few years where I think it's become common knowledge that you do need to do all this stuff to be able to perform your best, whether that's physically or if you're DJing or if you're just at work. And the dance music community is still quite difficult to remain healthy, especially people that do it full time. I've got friends that do it full time, and I do worry for them at points because you are kind of running in the red all the time, and it's going to have an effect at some point. It might not be now, but it might be 10, 20, 30 years down the line. So
totally.
Education's a big thing on that.
Yeah, definitely. I mean, even aside from the sort of partying side of it, obviously, we all like a party, and there's a lot of people out there that are probably DJing on a professional basis that will kick the arse out of it. But that aside, even just the touring, the traveling, the late nights, the lack of sleep, if you're spending your weekdays locked in a studio, it's quite a lonely profession as well. I think speaking to close friends of mine that are doing it on more of a full-time level and stuff as well, I do think that it's pretty common that it can have a negative impact on your mental health, right? Even without the party.
100%.
Yeah. And your physical health as well. I mean, I don't know about you, but I get quite bad tinnitus. It kind of flares up and depending on how much I've been DJing and what my lifestyle is like at the time and stuff. But I do sometimes stress about my ears. I know that they're damaged. I know that my hearing's not as good as it was. That side of it as well,
I actually went and got my ears tested a couple of weeks ago, and surprisingly the guy was you're pretty much bang on for your age. But he was because you're in nightclubs, he was you're going to have quite a steep drop off when you get to 50, 60. He was they will be more damaged than other people your age just now, but you're just not, you don't, feel it because you're the age that you are. He was like, hearing's the type of thing that everyone's will start to deteriorate, but the damage that you do to them now will, it's basically a bigger cliff that you're going to jump off rather than a shorter one.
Wow, that's worrying to hear that.
But then I've got the thing in my head, I'm like, medicine's getting better all the time. They'll be like,
well, I think that as well. I actually saw something online recently that there are some breakthroughs happening, and obviously AI is now becoming such a big thing that I feel like technology's moving at such a fast rate that there will be something where it's a little bit more reversible. I'm living in hope anyway.
Yeah, I know.
I'm living in hope. Stem cells and stuff like that are becoming big. Like, I'll be getting stem cells injected into my cochlea and in my inner ear or whatever. But I wear earplugs most of the time that I'm in the club that I'm not actually mixing. I used to wear them when I was mixing as well. I had like the ACS Pro ones. Mm-hmm. I'm sure that's the name of the brand. But years ago, I was DJing in Berlin, and we were all at a bar drinking afterwards, and something happened in the bar. It was so weird. I was with a group of friends, and I went to the toilet. And when I was in the toilet, it was just like a dingy wee sort of pub. It wasn't like a cool, like trendy bar in Berlin or whatever. It was just like a dingy wee pub. When I went to the toilet, a guy ran in the bar with a sword and attacked another guy. There was like a group of guys sat at a table behind us, and it was us sat at one table and them sat at another table basically the whole time we were there. And a guy ran in with a sword and attacked one of those other guys. And in the kerfuffle, my friends all like evacuated the bar, and my backpack was left sitting at the table, and my backpack got nicked. And I had my custom molded ACS earplugs and then, but I've never got the custom made ones since then. I've always just had like the cheaper versions of them.
Were they in your ears while?
No, they were.
All right, the guy with a sword coming in.
No, mate, I'm not gonna lie, I was pretty pissed. I had no clue. I came back out. There was blood all over the walls, and my mate Neil, actually Neil Flynn, I need to give a shout out to. He ran into the toilet. He was like, "You need to get out of here." Wow. I came out. There was blood all over the walls and everything. And then I was like, we were all outside, and I was like, where's my bag? Where's my bag? And I went back in and the bag was gone. But
yeah, you're not going to hunt a guy with a sword down.
Nah, but I've kind of veered off track a wee bit here. Basically, I should get the custom ones again, because I feel like to an extent, I don't know, I used to wear them when I was mixing as well, but then I felt like it was, you couldn't trust how loud things were in the club. Do you know what I mean? Like, you didn't.
Yeah, I find it difficult for, especially, I think high end it's fine, but like mid and low, I really struggled. I did try a couple times, but I'm just like, if I'm DJing, I just want to hear this as loud as possible.
Totally.
To be honest.
Yeah. It's like when you bring a track in, you're, for me, I'm like, oh, like, is that going tonto right now? Mm. I can't really tell because I've got the earplugs in. So now I really just, I put them in when I'm not mixing, and then I keep them in, and then I just try and not have my ears exposed to the noise as much as possible. Last time I got my ears checked, the guy said to me, we would have thought that your hearing would be better than it is for your age, basically. So mm-hmm. when you're telling me there's going to be a cliff drop at 50, I'm definitely going to have a hearing
maybe
aid.
Maybe not by then. Hopefully. Yeah. I've got every faith that they'll...
Yeah, same.
Might just get new ears. Brand new ears.
Yeah, same. So, next question, I'm actually going to quote you here. What does it mean to be a long-suffering hippie?
I think, like, football-wise, I think actually I wouldn't support any other team because it's given me a sense of humour, and I think it's important, especially if you're Scottish, to be able to laugh at yourself, and I think that's even more prevalent if you're a Hibs fan, because there's that famous saying, as Hibs that, isn't it? So I think it's just you know you can't choose who you support. It's your parents or an older sibling or someone that you look up to will pick that team for you generally. I don't know if it's still the same anymore. a few of my friends who've got slightly older kids, they seem to support three or four different, they kind of support players more than more than teams now. But yeah, I think I'm just used to being excited and then getting let down almost instantly after the excitement peaks.
Yeah, it's character building, though.
Yeah, that's what it is.
It's character building.
Yeah, I wouldn't have it any other way.
Yeah, yeah. I think you're right in what you're saying there as well. It's important to be able to have a laugh at yourself. I think that's something that Scottish people do really well. We've got a good sense of humour and the ability to be shat on from a very high height and find it funny.
I think it's quite funny, especially because I travel with Max all the time. The way that we speak to each other, if you're in... Even like London, for instance, if you're playing parties for people who are maybe from a slightly higher standing in society and they see the way that you speak to each other, they're like, are they about to start fighting with each other? And you're like, no, it's like endearment.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah. Like me messaging you yesterday saying, tell Baze, I said, he's a serpent.
I know, I actually forgot to tell him as well, but I'll text him when we leave.
Yeah, yeah, text him when you leave. Aye. So do you go to a lot of the games then?
No, because I'm still playing football. Because I'm still playing football, I don't get the opportunity. And again, with like DJing, like the team that I'm playing for have been like super understanding that I'm not going to be there all the time because it is a big commitment. Yeah, my wife won't mind me saying that I've got her full support when it comes to music, but it's the opposite when it comes to football.
Yeah.
Why would you go and do something that when you come, you can't get out of bed on a Sunday morning after playing and then you're covered in like cuts and bruises on a Saturday night after it? But I'm just like, I think if you're into football, it's just like, it's something that I think I've retired twice, and after about 6 months I'm just like, just climbing the walls. But no, I think I'd like to take my daughter to some games when she's a bit older, maybe when the weather's a bit better as well, but she's 2.5 now, so I think she's I think my dad took me to my first Edinburgh Derby when I was like 3 weeks old.
Wow.
She's starting a little bit later, but she seems to like football.
Yeah, so cool.
Hopefully she's gonna be into it.
Yeah, nice.
I'm not gonna be one of those pushy parents, I don't think. I say that now.
Yeah. Soccer mum.
Yeah, that's it. Yeah, that's it.
Yeah, yeah. So what's the plans for the future then? Obviously, we're missing Max today. And you had mentioned to me off camera that you may be starting some solo stuff as well.
Yeah,
is that right?
I've got a gig on New Year's Eve, which is like a little basement kind of venue in Perth, which I'm playing for a couple of friends. I've been saying this for like 6 or 7 years, but one of my friends, Mike, who I used to run Groovement with, he's a really good producer. He's done stuff as Eli and Crossover Network. So he's had releases on some really good labels. We've been talking for ages about getting in the studio and kind of fanning around and seeing if we can come up with stuff. So I'm going to do that with him. But I think, yeah, predominantly it'll still be Craigie Now stuff because that's what I love doing, and I get to spend time with my best mate doing it. So I think maybe if we're being slightly more picky with our Craigie Now's gigs, it might free up some time to do kind of bar gigs or like some smaller gigs locally, which I like doing as well, because although there's quite a good synergy between us when we DJ, it's always nice to like play on your own as well. And he's probably the same. You get to kind of go in a different direction.
Yeah, definitely. Have you done any messing around in the studio so far yourself? Or have you
So I did. I did a course with Simon Stokes at his studio, which was amazing. Yeah. And I have noodled around with Push and stuff like that, but I think it's something, again, because we've been so busy with the label and gigs and then everything else, that's we've not had the time to fully commit to it. And I always feel that we get sent music from such amazing producers that it would be selfish for us to start putting out our own music that one, we don't have the talent of other artists that send us stuff, and two, we don't have the time to fully commit to production. But it's definitely something that I'm keen to do, but I don't want to rush it. We've not rushed anything in the past and it seems to have worked out right. So I don't want to get to the stage where I'm just putting out music for the sake of it. We did release one record. Well, we did a track on a compilation that we did years ago, which was like an acid, like kind of slow electro track. And that was really fun to make. But again, Max is a lot better on Ableton than I am. So I think I'd like to get to the stage where I'm comfortable doing it on my own. I can use Ableton, but again, it's just, like I said, with DJing, it's, you know, it's practice, and I've not put enough practice into warrant getting releases and stuff like that. So I think it's something that will come eventually, but I'm in no rush.
With the label, obviously you mentioned there that you get a lot of amazing music sent to you by different artists and stuff. It's great that you're in that position where the music's coming to you. But I suppose when you started out, was there a specific sound that you were looking for, or are you really looking to try and identify or have an identity musically with the label? Or
no, I think there is kind of a general sound to what we do, and I think there's definitely influences from Detroit, although it's not really a Detroit sounding label, but there are influences from that, because that's where we kind of, that's our favorite stuff, is the stuff that comes out of there or has come out of there. But in regards to the sound, not really. We didn't like pick a genre and say we're going to be like a electro label. And magazines and stuff have tried to pigeonhole us in the past. And I mean, that's just what happens. Everyone wants to kind of put someone in a box, but we just release stuff that we like. Like the one that is coming out soon, the Pascal Project one, is almost like a pop record. But not pop in this sense of kind of what it is now. It's kind of like a 90s pop record with the kind of house backing track, but then like kind of floaty vocals over the top of it. So we're not precious about the stuff that we release. As long as we like it, then we'll put it out. But I think that there is like an overall sound that that we have, but I couldn't sum it up in words. It's just kind of a way that music makes us feel, and then we'll put it out.
Couldn't pinpoint it really, yeah. But is there something else I actually wanted to ask you was then, is there a difference in the criteria that you're looking for with the music that you're looking for your DJ sets, or is there?
Yeah, 100%. There's stuff that I would play and DJ sets that I love, but I wouldn't sign it because I think that's maybe too far removed from what we do. And it doesn't mean that I don't love it like I do, but I think there has to be some form of consistency. But what that is, I couldn't explain. But there's just a sound that I think now we're comfortable with, and there's elements of tracks that I think you get to the stage where you only have to listen to something for 10 seconds to figure out whether you like it or not, because you've listened to that much music. And then you maybe only need to listen to it a couple of times to work out whether you're going to go and try and get it for the label or not. But no, I wouldn't say there's a whole much difference in the stuff that we play and the stuff that we put out. But There's definitely some tracks that we play in DJ sets that just we probably wouldn't do them justice if we were to sign them on the label. I think they're probably better suited to other labels. And there has been stuff that we've turned down that we really, really like, but then if we know that they've approached other labels that would probably suit better, we would, because we want the best for the artist at the end of the day, we would say maybe you're better suited off going with them for this one, because you'd probably get a better response for the crowd that you're trying to go towards.
That's really cool. It's admirable as well, yeah. And For me, from an outsider's perspective, sorry, looking at you guys and what label's doing just now, I'd say it's probably one of the hottest underground dance labels in the UK at the moment. So what do you think has been the key to the success?
Max. No, just generally having a love for like dance music. Mm-hmm. Like I think electronic music, especially Max might have a different answer, but I think for me, not necessarily, you know how people say, oh, I feel like the music's talking to me. Mm. I think for me, it's more, I know what that person's feeling without any words being described. Like it'll make me feel a certain way. And often that is kind of that malevolent, darker, kind of scary sounding stuff. But it's also got like a bit of, it's basically kind of like black soulful music, but so it's got mm-hmm. funk to it, but it's not, there's no words effectively. It's like, I hate it in movies when there's clearly a bad person, but then like there'll be a line in the movie where they say, and you've been bad for 20 years. It's like, I know that, like, you don't have to explain it to me. Or in like country music, they specifically outline what they're singing about. Whereas the thing that I like about electronic music is they don't need words to do that. Mm. They can make you feel a certain way, or you can understand how they feel without any words being exchanged. And I like that as opposed to the kind of clear and obvious, kind of just straight down the barrel stuff. I find it more interesting when you can kind of make little stories up in your own head rather than being told what to think.
That's really cool, man. It's an interesting take on it. I've never really heard someone describe it in that way, but I mean, I can certainly relate to, you know, feeling the energy from a track. And there's tracks that are just pure 100% evil, mm-hmm. and there's tracks that there's no words in them, but it's evil.
Yeah,
it's
like
acid and breaksy and like really dark. And I mean, to be honest, like a lot of the music that I've made myself is like pretty dark and stuff, but then you get tracks that are euphoric and mm-hmm. like the chord change is like, oh, it's almost like you play something like that at the end of the night and it's like reflective on the experience mm-hmm. that you've had, you know, like there's no doubt that you can tell a story with music really without the lyrics being involved. And I suppose with the DJing as well, you know, you can, like we were saying earlier on, take the crowd on a journey. You can kind of tell a story throughout the night.
And that's maybe one slight gripe that I've got with people calling like this new TikTok techno is like hard dance, and I'm like, it's not hard.
No.
Like there's tracks that are like, I've seen Andrew Weatherall play it the whole night at Sub Club at 116 BPM and mm-hmm. people are punching holes in the fucking roof. Do you know what I mean?
Yes.
Or like old Robert Armani tracks that are maybe like 125 BPM, but they hit way harder than the stuff that's
totally
like 150 BPM.
Definitely.
So like speed isn't a good gauge of how hard or how striking something is. It's about like, if it's got like a funk and a groove to it, and that doesn't necessarily mean in like the disco sense, it's like it's got swing to it basically.
I couldn't agree with you more. I mean, some of the stuff, the chuggy sort of sounding stuff, like really hard, punchy, evil, mm-hmm. and some of this TikTok dance music stuff, it's like sped up. It'll be like a sample of like, I don't know, Barbie Girl or something, and like sped up, like there's nothing nothing hard about it.
Yeah, and I think the whole thing with again, I don't want to sound like I don't want to come across like I'm bad mouthing again, there's a reason it's become popular.
Yeah.
And that's because it's quite easily accessible and it's a good gateway into dance music for people. But the whole thing of like playing a track because it's ironic, I just find like there's so much good music out there and there's so many producers that spend so much time making really amazing, interesting music.
Mm.
Like playing something because it's ironic isn't actually, like, I don't find that funny. Like that's not why people are into dance music. I think your job as a DJ is to make people dance and have a good time, but also introduce them to new stuff that they might like as well. And without sounding snobbish, like if someone played like Barbie Girl or whatever, I'd just be like, it's not original either because it's been done 1,000 times. And like, if I wanted to hear that, I wouldn't be here.
Yeah, 100%. I mean, like you said, obviously, if it's a gateway, it's good. If it's getting more people into dance music overall, it's a good overall, you know, it's a good thing. And there's positives to it, right? If they're going to, you know, if they're going to start listening to this stuff and then...
I think the only people that I've seen do it properly or hear doing it properly, like Optimal.
Yeah.
Like they know what they're doing.
Yeah, totally.
So it's like not everyone can do that.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
Everyone
totally.
Shouldn't. So like they're good at that sort of stuff. Like I was speaking to Cy last night and we were talking about a festival that we played up in Inverness and Optimal were playing. And Max actually said, he was like, we were with my little brother who hadn't seen them before. And Max was like, honestly, they're crazy. They'll like play like Motorhead, Ace of Spades or something. And then I'm not joking, about 3 minutes later, the drums for Ace of Spades came in. And he was just like, you just like picked out a thin air, just like one crazy track that wouldn't actually fit in a dance music set. But it sounded amazing because they're good at doing it.
Yeah.
I think Morris Fulton apparently is good at like just picking like an old Doors track and just playing it in the middle of like a techno set or whatever, and it works. But
yeah.
I think when it's people who are doing it, and they're not doing it to get a funny reaction. They're doing it because it works. So I think it's pretty obvious when people are doing it, especially there was that whole phase of people playing like, they would play like no matter what type of set it was. And then they would, no matter, there was like a 4 or 5 year period, it was always a disco track as the last track.
And I
did it as well.
Yeah, but then
it's like the older you get, it's like you realize that it is a bit old hat and you should just kind of be true to yourself rather than trying to do what's popular.
Definitely. Yeah, I mean, Optimal, as you said, they're amazing. Like big fans of theirs. I actually wanted to try and get them on the podcast at some point as well. But guys like that, they do it well. It's like, you know, there's no real, I think with them, there's almost like not a definitive, I suppose their sound is just like Optimal. Like the identity is, it's Optimal, but that is, it could be like The Clash and then like Grandmaster Flash and Furious Five, or it could be loads of stuff in and amongst like House Electro, whatever,
100%.
Techno, which is amazing. But yeah, I also, for me, I think when I was going out clubbing all the time, what excited me was hearing something that I've never heard before and that feeling of like, oh my God, what is that? And not even just never heard, like never heard anything like it before, you know, like what is that, you know, like goosebumps standing up, hair standing up in the back of your neck, like that kind of thing.
And it was more fun because you didn't have Shazam. So you had to really be like, you had to really look for it, or you had to go trawl through Discogs or there's a track that Dominic played in Croatia at a festival, and I'm not joking, we stayed up for, I think it was 18 hours looking for this one track. And we kept saying to each other, it's definitely a Fast Eddie track. So we went through all of Fast Eddie's tracks and then we were like, maybe it's on this label. And then actually, I swear to God, we didn't leave the living room for like 18 hours, just like getting melted trying to find this one track. And then after like 18 hours, I was like, I've got his number, why don't I just text him? So I just texted him, and like 3 minutes later, I got the track, and it was like a Jimi Edgar track. I was like,
that is amazing, man. Yeah, yeah.
But you don't get that now because you can just Shazam it and find it.
But then some things you like won't pick up, right? I mean, obviously if it's unreleased, but then there's other things that I suppose are just like too off radar, like too rare. And
I think that's where I like, that's maybe where I am kind of selfish when it comes to DJing, because every people might not say it, but there is something, there's such a nice feeling about playing stuff and then people come up to the booth and be like what is that, I've never heard it before. And I would never say you're not getting it. I would always like show them what the record is, but that's like probably one of my favorite things to happen, is people come up and be like what is that.
Yeah, definitely. I think there's an importance in that. I think you should really be trying to play things that other people aren't playing, and like as you said, introducing people to music. But I think if you know, if you get something that's like 300 copies, like Lavina Lonely, mm-hmm. you know, it's nice to have something that not everybody is going to be playing. And yeah, I think that is something that people should be striving for as a DJ. Definitely, Yogi Hotton was saying that as well.
Yeah, because it separates you from everyone else, and you need to have your own identity as a DJ. Otherwise, what's the point in booking you? It's like, I would feel like a fraud if I knew that I was just playing the same types of music or the same tracks as like the other 10 DJs in that scene. Do you know what I mean? I'd much rather play. Discovering music is like the best part about the job. So I spend probably like at least 6 to 8 hours a week just trawling through music or labels that I haven't heard before. And you're probably the same. You'll go 3 days without finding anything decent,
yeah,
pulling your hair out, and then you'll go through like a purple patch of finding loads of amazing stuff. And it's one of the best feelings ever.
Definitely. And like you said there, I think it's so important to try and create an identity. I mean, you look at some of the people that are like the top of the scene. Ricardo Villalobos, he's really got an identity, right? A DJ identity. You know, other people that maybe you might be a fan of them, you might not be, but even, you know, like Dixon, for example, like really got an identity, right? To the point where someone like me or you, if you walked into like someone's house and they were playing something on SoundCloud, you'd maybe quickly be able to tell like, is this like a Dixon set or is this a Ricardo Villalobos set? And, you know, guys like that, they've obviously been at the top of the game for a long time, and they've remained there for a reason. That's maybe partly to do with it, right? They've created an identity.
100%. I actually heard someone, I can't remember who it was, but they said that Ricardo Villalobos is the best DJ in the world at playing bad tracks and making them sound good. Because if you go through his set list, say there's like 40 tracks, you're like, 35 of them sound horrific on their own, but the way that he molds them together, it sounds amazing.
Yeah, unbelievable. Like, and to be honest, we were talking about the irony. I've heard him play some things where I'm like, is this ironic?
Yeah.
But he makes it work. I have to admit, I have maybe seen him on the odd occasion, maybe more than the odd occasion, where he's maybe been a wee bit too on the wonky side as well. But
no, I'm the same. I think I've seen him 6 times. 2 were amazing. The other 4, I couldn't understand what was going on.
Yeah, maybe we're just not operating on the same level mentally at that point. Like, maybe he's, whatever state he's in, he's just sort of operating in a different headspace, and we're not fully understanding it. But I think, yeah, there's times you go and see him as well, or I've gone to see him, where you're stood there, like we were saying, and you're like, what is that? Like, it's not just what is the track, like, you've not heard anything like it, you know? Mm-hmm. There was a famous, was it like a tweet or something that Midland had posted that had been a bit viral, and he was talking about going to see Ricardo and maybe like Radish and Radu or something, and being stood there like, what is this voodoo sorcery that's going on right now, you know? Yeah, definitely, man. That's, for me, that's the exciting thing about going to see someone DJ and being on the other side of the dance floor. Definitely. Listen, Mitch, we're running a wee bit shy on time just now. Before we go, where can people that are listening find you? Could you maybe give them some links, social media?
Yeah,
media
so just Craigie Nows on Instagram, and then Craigie Nows on Bandcamp. And then that's SoundCloud as well as Craigie Nows.
Cool.
And then there'll be links to like personal and private stuff on there as well. So definitely follow us on Instagram, because you'll get new releases before they come out and stuff like that. So
nice. And
follow.
Are there any releases coming up really soon? You might have mentioned one earlier, actually.
Yeah, so we've got, I'm trying to remember whose ones have been announced yet, but we've got DJ Life's doing another one. We've got Pascal Project, which is the kind of more poppy one that's coming out. Feather Cap's doing another one. So we've got a pretty strong Australian contingency at the moment.
Nice.
So there's lots of that sound and stuff coming out. And then next year we've got some kind of big acts who've been doing it for like 30 years who are coming out, but I can't mention who it is yet.
Ah, amazing.
It'll
amazing.
Be good. I'll tell you off camera.
Yeah, nice one. Nice, nice. And gig-wise, you said that you're playing on New Year's Eve?
Yes.
Yeah.
I don't know if it's sold out yet, but I think it's pretty close to, and that's in Perth. It's the basement of Cafe 80. And then we're actually playing Sneaky Pete's for the first time on the 28th of December. So
nice.
It's a 5 a.m. license as well. So
nice, nice.
Should be good.
So if you're in Edinburgh, come and check it
out.
Yes, please. Yeah, wicked. All right, nice one, man. Thanks very much for coming on.
You.
It's been great talking to you. I've really enjoyed it.
You too.
So thanks very much, man.